majority of the work. Sophie is flame working. So flame working is a little bit different than like the pieces you saw inside. So Dale Chihuly likes to work with a team. He still works here in Seattle. He works with a team up to 15 different people sometimes. So the more people you have in the hot shop or the studio, the bigger the pieces you're going to be able to make. Another pretty big difference between flame working and glassblowing is that when you're glassblowing, you have a big long metal pole. That's a punty, that's your blowpipe. When you're flame working, you can have kind of a little bit more solo oriented focus. You're not using any metal punties, you're all entire tube. So he's holding is made of glass. So they are able to hold pretty close to the flame, like you can see. That's because glass is a pretty poor conductor of heat, so none of that heat is traveling up the tube there.
And what I just did is this color in particular is really sensitive. And so first I coated it in some carbon, that's the black stuff that's on the glass. And then as it started heating up more, I could add more oxygen. But now before I make something, I need to divide this tube into a smaller section. It's more glass than what I would like to work with at one time. So now I can just stretch it.
So cool.
That's my favorite part.
But it cools down really fast, so now while it's still really hot and I can't touch it, it's way too cold to actually work with. So now I can just melt it off here and let this glass that I stretched out a little earlier, let that just cool down on its own. But now I would like to remove a little bit of this extra glass before I start to add some more color to this glass. And I'll be adding some polka dots, so it will look similar, but a little different to that ornament.
So you saw this, you're using that really, really big flame at first.
Showed it to the minor plane. That allows you to kind of have a little bit more spot focusing. Really control, kind of flat focus area. Yeah, so it's all glass. And it's still a tube. So again, I just want to be kind of gentle with this glass because it is sensitive. So I'm just preheating it before I take this solid stick of gray and apply dots in a very specific pattern.
So kind of like you saw in the Northwestern, those baskets with all those really intricate designs. You take a cane or a rod of glass, melt it down, you can essentially draw directly onto it. You can see it still has that texture there, applying the dots. Sophie continues to heat and melt the piece. It's just going to melt it down so it becomes all of a solid, flush texture.
And as I add all these dots, I want to make sure that they're not only roughly the same size, but also evenly spaced apart, because everywhere where I'm adding a dot, I'm adding more material, more mass, and I want it to be as even of a layer of color as possible so that my glass blows out pretty evenly. Gonna do a few more rows of dots.
She's just kind of gently flicking her wrist at the end to pull and remove the cane from the piece.
And I can only see what's happening because of the glasses that I'm wearing. They're called endymion lenses, and they block out that orange sodium flare that you're all seeing when the glass is in the flame, allowing me to really see what's happening so I know when it's ready to work with and manipulate. And now I'll start to heat everything in and then also start to blow the glass.
You can also see Sophie's constantly rotating her hand, always keeping that heat in motion. When we melt that glass, it becomes really malleable, so it's going to pull in different directions. So making sure that we're using that centrifugal force really keeps the piece in one.
I'm getting ready to start to blow the glass, and when I'm blowing, it's going to be really light and puffs of air. The glass, when it comes out of the heat, it's at its hottest. So it really wants to expand and it wants to move, and if I blow too hard, when it's as hot as it is, I will blow the glass too thin too soon, When the glass gets paper thin, as soon as it heats back up, it wants to shrivel up like cellophane. And now as I'm starting to expand it more, the thinner it gets, the faster it's going to heat up, and also the faster it's going to cool down, so I have to make more frequent trips back to the heat.
You can see those dots that Sophie was applying. They are starting to melt down. They don't have as much of that texture initially, becoming one solid, kind of flush texture.
Mm-hmm.
And you can kind of control as well. If you hold the piece up, it's going to make more of a splatter shape. When you blow into it, holding it down, it's going to elongate.
Focus the heat on the very bottom, and then use my graphite paddle just to flatten it.
Just really lightly touching against there, not too firm. That head scratcher looking tool, that's a claw. That's gonna basically act as an extension of so she's dipping the tips of that claw into the heat. We want to make sure it's nice and hot so we don't shock our glass. She's just cinching it on there. Glass is still too hot to touch with her hand, so the claw makes it a little easy.
And before I start to remove my tube, I just want to make sure that my tube is a little longer. I want to elongate the neck of my vase. And then now, I'll do a little bit more. And then now I'm going to start to blow it super thin so that I can use the flame to cut the glass apart.
You're going to see just how thin glass can get when you blow into it. So it's going to make a nice little bubble there. Really thin, like cellophane. Dips it back in the flame and it cuts open. So she's removed the rest of the tube. Just gonna kind of heat that down and use that kind of like a tool to pull apart some of the excess glass there.
It's nice to use glass as a tool because it's not stealing any heat out of the existing hot material, and then also hot glass really